It's a joy and privilege for me to be here with all of you, along with my wife. We thank God for this opportunity to look into the Word of God and to know what God has for us at this special time when we remember what God did for us on the cross. I want us to begin as we look into the Word. This evening we're going to be talking about the way to holiness is in fulfilling His purpose. That's the topic that I'm going to cover this evening. But to begin with, to look at the whole understanding of holiness and what, why is it so important, why is it so significant for us as God's people, I just want to begin with a passage in 2 Corinthians chapter 6. So if you have your Bibles, you'd like you to turn with me to that passage in 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verses 17 and 18. Therefore, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. And then chapter 7 and verse 1. Therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Let me read that 7th chapter, the first verse. Therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Shall we just pause for a word of prayer? Father Lord, we just thank you and praise you that, Lord, you are a God who desires holiness from us. Lord, that, Father, we are not here to just survive in this world. We are called to be a holy people. We are called to be a people separated unto you, Lord. Father, there is no other work for us. There is no other task for us here on earth, but a task of being holy and separated unto you. And to, Lord, to know that you are our God who has a plan and a purpose for our lives. And we are here to fulfill that purpose. So, Lord, we commit ourselves this evening into your hand. We pray that, Lord, you will speak to us in a wonderful way, that we will understand your thoughts, your words, and your desires, and apply it into our lives. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. See, when we look at the cross has so much of significance and so much of meaning. But as for me, when I look at the cross in a fresh way this time of Lent, what comes to me in a very special way is, this is a God who came down and said, I love you. I want you for myself. This is who he is. This is our God. He is a God who is so much in love with us. He wants us exclusively for himself. He does not want us to be separated from him. Because holiness is about being, to separate ourselves, to separate ourselves from the world and to be separated unto God. And this is what God wants. He wants us exclusively for himself. He's in a love relationship with us. He's in a deep, 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 deep love relationship with us. You know, sometimes when we come to the cross, we are more transactional, you know, in terms of the cross. Oh, the cross is about my salvation. The cross is about my sins being forgiven. The cross is about my relationship with the Heavenly Father. All of that is absolutely right, because that's what the cross does give us. But the cross, in how the way I look at it is, the cross is ultimately, it's about God wanting us back for himself. Because that's how it was in the Garden of Eden. We had that closeness. We had that intimacy. We were in a love relationship with God. Genesis chapter 1 and 2 is about that love relationship. We were deeply in love with God and he was in love with us. We enjoyed that fellowship. We enjoyed that closeness. That's how God intended it to be from the very beginning. Everything flows out of that relationship. Everything flows out of that closeness with God. If we don't have that closeness, that intimacy, that love relationship with God, life is meaningless. Life is pointless. I mean, you can try to use God for your own ends. Of course, true. We can use God for our ends. God does answer prayer. You can say, God, I need this, I need that, I need to survive, I need to make ends meet, and etc., etc. And of course, God will hear our prayer. But God says this, that's not what I'm here for. I am here to love you. And I want you to love me back. He wants us to have that intimacy with him. And friends, this evening, the question we'll have to ask ourselves is a very important question. Are you enjoying that love relationship with God? You may call yourself a believer. You may call yourself born again, etc., etc. You may say anything about yourself. And you say, I've been with the Lord, I've been walking with the Lord for many years. So what? But is there an intimacy with God, a closeness with God, a love relationship with God today? Is it current? Is it absolutely current now that you can talk of a testimony of not what happened 10 years ago or 15 years ago and say, you know, I accepted Christ as my personal savior? That's not relevant. What is relevant is today, is there a love relationship with God? Is there the warmth? Is there a joy? Or has that warmth disappeared? Is there a plateauing that many of us unfortunately have arrived at? We've started plateauing with God. We've come to a point where everything seems very routine. We know that this is how it works. You know, we are very familiar. Oh, this is how I have to pray. This is how I have to read the Bible. This is how I am supposed to worship. These are worship songs I'm supposed to sing. You know, we're very familiar with all of this. Familiarity is very dangerous. Familiarity with God is very, very dangerous. I must be in a vibrant, exciting love relationship with God. It must be absolutely current. It must be so exciting. It must be throbbing inside of me that nothing else matters. Lord, I don't want anything else. I don't need success. I don't need significance. I don't need importance. I don't need people to say this about me or that about me. Absolute rubbish. I don't need that. What I want, Lord, is a love relationship with you. Is that how it is? Is that how it is? Very important question. And you, each of us, will have to answer that question. Because if that is not there, if that throb of love is not there, we'll have to go to God with brokenness and go to God and say, Lord, I've lost it. I've lost it. Somewhere down the line, I lost it. It became routine. It became very familiar, Lord. I thought everything is going fine. Father, forgive me because I've lost that deep, throbbing love relationship with you. And this Lent time is about that. This whole purpose of the cross is about to bring us back into that love relationship with God. Now, friends, as we think about this love relationship with God and this closeness with God, because that is where holiness comes. That is where we are one with Him. It requires us to see certain very, very specific things begin to happen in our lives. You know, God is not a God who is vague. God is very clear. He's very specific. He says there has to be certain steps that needs to fall into place. There are certain building blocks that need to fall into place in our lives if we are talking about holiness. Holiness is not a vague concept. It's real. It is hands-on. It's where the rubber hits the road. It's an everyday experience of holiness, and it has to be measured. You'll have to ask yourself, am I actually living a life of holiness? Is the question we'll have to ask. And so we're going to look at this passage in Luke's Gospel chapter 1, the passage that was read to us, and see what it means in terms of the purpose for our lives. Because, you know, in terms of holiness, God has a purpose for us. We can't be drifters in this world. We can't be just like anybody else, say, you know, I'm also trying to be a Christian. Sorry, you know, you got to move on. There's no room for this. God has a purpose for our lives. And you and I better be sure, what is your calling? What is your purpose? Every one of us has a purpose. I'm not saying that we are all expected to become pastors or evangelists or so-called full-time workers. And I believe every one of us is full-time. There is nothing called full-time and part-time. Every one of us is full-time. Wherever you are, is a purpose for God. You may be in IT, you may be in industry, you may be in business, you may be in education, you may be in law, you may be in science, you may be in any field. But you need to discern and know that I am where I am because this is God's purpose for my life. I am here because I'm separated from everything else. I'm not running after money. I'm not running after status. I'm not running after an image in life. I'm running after fulfilling God's purpose. This has to be absolutely clear. Holiness involves a clarity of purpose. We cannot be drifters. And again, this question that comes to us this evening is, how many of us here this evening really know what our purpose is for our lives? Not only we know what is our purpose, we are actually involved in fulfilling the purpose. We are engaged in the task that God has given to us. You cannot afford to say, I don't know God's purpose for my life. I'm still searching. God is wanting us to know his purpose for us. He wants us to be engaged in that purpose. So turn with me to Luke's Gospel chapter 1. And as we look at this beautiful story here about Zachariah and Elizabeth, which I'm sure is a very, very familiar story. Let's see how the holiness of God's holiness of God for our lives becomes a reality in terms of us fulfilling His purpose. Now, I want to begin with verse 19, Luke's Gospel, chapter 1, and verse 19. And the angel answered and said to him, I am Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God, and was sent to speak to you and bring you these glad tidings. You know, God's purpose begins with God. It does not begin with us. Sadly, many times, Christians in their over-enthusiasm try to define their own calling, and they end up into a mess. And I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. Many people begin to say, this is what I believe is the calling that God has for my life, and they end up totally ruining themselves because it was not what was coming from the heart of God. It was something of their own imagination, something of their own, you know, that they worked up on themselves. Very dangerous. We must be very clear that God's purpose begins with God. And I must always be able to say, Lord, it is not about my plan. It is not about my agenda that I have in life. What is your plan, O God, for me? Lord, I want to know your plan. I put aside everything else. You know, many of us sadly come to God already with a predetermined agenda, and then we expect God to do some kind of a magic and, you know, put our finger somewhere there and say, oh yes, God confirmed it, brother. Now I know my calling. You know, you came with your own agenda. You have not been willing to put aside your plan and come to God with an open sheet and say, Lord, there is no plan. There is no agenda of mine. I am not running after anything that I thought was right for me. I am here to do your plan. Are we ready for that? I don't think many of us are willing. Because we are very scared. We want to plan life. We have our own agenda set. We have worked out A, B, C, and D. We know if this doesn't happen, I got a fallback option. I've got something set for myself. You know, everything is okay. Let God, you please guide me here. So that, you know, I'm somehow doing your plan also, and also taking care of my security. My safety is also looked after. You know, don't play games with God. Please. Please don't play games with God. God sees us through and through. He knows there's a horrible level of hypocrisy when we try to do this. Come to God with an open sheet. Lord, I don't have any agenda, Lord. No plans. Lord, your purpose. I'm here to fulfill your purpose. Are we ready for that? This is holiness. Don't talk of holiness if you're not willing to come to God with a blank sheet of paper and be willing to listen to Him and say, yes, Lord, I'm willing to obey. Many of us are not willing to obey because we are very, 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 you know, very particular about our own safety, our own security, our children's safety, our children's security. We want to set all that in place first. Then we'll say, God, please show me your will also. Hello, you can't do that. You can't do that. You've got to come to God and say, Lord, I'm here to fulfill your purpose. So Gabriel, Luke's Gospel chapter 1 verse 19, the angel answered and said to him, I'm Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God and was sent to speak to you and bring you these glad tidings. You and I are basically Gabriels. In a sense, we stand and receive God's message. The mission, the purpose that God has for life, or for us, for our life, is not only for us, it is for God to do something beyond us. So you and I are basically receiving God's purpose from God, from His heart, and we are bringing it and transferring it. We are not the owners of the mission. You're not owners of the purpose. Sometimes many people I find will start a ministry and say, brother, this is my ministry. I started this ministry. I was the one who founded this ministry. Sorry, you don't found anything. You don't create anything. You and I are only the messengers. You and I are only the stewards. You are only a person who carries the message, the purpose of God, and transfers it. You cannot hold this purpose to yourself and claim ownership of it. None of us can claim that. I hope you get what I'm saying. Many of us in ministry and so-called ministry, we think I am the one who's made this. You don't make anything. You're only a steward. You always hold this ministry of God, which begins with God, with an open hand and say, Lord, this is yours. I'm only a steward, Lord. Please let me not get so caught up with this that I begin to own it. And then when my position starts shaking, I get very anxious, very troubled. I get very insecure. Look at how much of insecurity we have today in ministry. because we feel this is our ministry. The ministry is never yours. Ministry is always God's. You and I are only messengers who transfer the message of God into our situations, into our circumstances. So we are in that sense Gabriel. Now Gabriel comes and delivers the message to Zacharias. Now you come to the 18th verse. We go one verse earlier. We looked at the 19th verse, Luke 1. Look at the 18th verse. And Zacharias said to the angel, "How shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife is well advanced in years." Here was the purpose of God, and we are saying, when we are in tune with the purpose of God, we are being people who are separated from the things of the world. We are separated unto God. We're fulfilling His purpose. We are here to accomplish His purpose. We find Zachariah is now raising up his limitations, all his, you know, his own issues. He says, "Gabriel, you're telling me that there is a message of God, but I'm an old man, and Elizabeth is also old. How can this be?" You know, friends, very sadly, whenever God communicates His purpose to our lives, many of us immediately bring up all our, you know, things that we think will be the difficulties. "Oh, how can this be, Lord? How can this be? I am this, I am that, I don't have this, I don't have that." You know, our limitations, all our own issues that we keep running our life with, we bring it to God. And we say, "Lord, how can I fulfill your purpose? You know, I've got a family, I've got children, I've got my hand here, I've got business there. How can I do this purpose?" And sadly, many of us, because of bringing up our own limitations before God, we miss out of what God has for us. Friends, this evening, once again, very important question. Are you raising your limitations to God? Giving all your excuses, saying, "Oh Lord, how can this be? How can it?" Very genuine. What Zacharias was telling Gabriel was absolutely genuine. And many of us feel what excuse I'm giving to God is also very genuine. But friends, remember this, God is God. Zacharias may be old, Elizabeth may be old, that does not limit God. That does not limit God. That does not limit His plan. It does not limit His purpose. Unfortunately, we are the ones who are raising up limitations. Holiness is saying, "Lord, it is your plan. My life is in tune with you. I'm not here to bring up any limitations, Lord. I'm here to fulfill your agenda. I'm here to fulfill your purpose. My limitations, sure, it's quite serious. It's a quite a big issue. But Lord, I put aside my limitations. I'm here to follow after you. Are we ready?" But sadly, many of us are, you know, so tightly fixed with our limitations. "How can this be, Lord? How can I fulfill your purpose?" We miss out of the holiness. We miss out of being separated and sanctified to God. The very purpose of the cross, friends, was for us to be in that closeness with God. But you cannot talk of closeness if I'm not willing to be engaged with God's purpose. Then let's move on. Then we'll see something beautiful about this couple. If you come down to the 6th verse, Luke's Gospel chapter 1 and verse 6. It says there, "And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord, blameless. But they had no child, because Elizabeth was barren, and they were both well advanced in years." Now, a beautiful, experience is being shown here for us. Here were this husband and wife who were going through a very serious personal crisis, a very, very deep crisis. And a crisis like this is something that is too hurting. I'm sure you understand what this means. Something that you can't even talk about. You find it very difficult to even talk about this to anybody. But it's there. It's always there. You don't have a child. And there's no hope for a child. Here are this husband and wife carrying this pain for years. Put yourself, if each of us were to put ourselves in this couple's place, in that position, how would we have been responding to life? And I would think many of us would become very bitter, very negative. oh, you know, of course God is good, but brother, I don't know why this problem has not gone. I don't know why God did not give us the joy of having a child. Why did this happen? You know, many of us today sadly carry our own bitterness. I don't know, this evening you are sitting here, I don't know what you are carrying. I really don't know what you are carrying. Maybe for years there is a bitterness in your heart. I don't know, maybe a hurt, maybe a pain, maybe some kind of an injustice that was done to you, maybe something very old, you know, you cannot forget, but you will hold it in your heart and you will pretend as though everything is okay, but that pain is not gone. But look at this example of this family, this husband and wife. The sixth verse is so beautiful. And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord, blameless. That means, in spite of their pain, in spite of their hurt, in spite of that deep pain in their heart, they did not allow that to come in the way of their relationship with God. They walked in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord, blameless. What an example. Friends, this is what it means to be prepared to be separated unto God, to be holy unto God. This evening, God is speaking to us. And if we are tending to carry some hurts, some old issues which we are not able to let go, we are not able to forgive people, you know, we carry some hurts which are for years, we don't want to let it go, and we think we have every right to hold on to those pain. Friends, this evening God is speaking to us and saying, if you have to be holy, this is what you have to let go. This is what I came for. The cross was in order to set us free from all these kind of issues. Let's not talk about the cross. Oh, my sins are forgiven, but I won't give up the hurt. I won't give up that old, you know, problem that happened in my life years ago. I won't let it go. I will still keep it. What is this? What kind of a salvation is that? What kind of a personal relationship with God is that? This evening, God is expecting every one of us to let go of those hurts. Go to God and say, Lord, I've carried this pain for too long. I want to be like Elizabeth and Zacharias. They had a pain, Lord, but they were people who let it go. They said, Lord, we will follow your ordinances blameless. Let's take the example of this beautiful couple and say, Lord, this is the kind of life I want. If there has to be holiness, Lord, it cannot be as though I can keep carrying those hurts and the pain in my life and keep trying to please God. It doesn't work this way. So this was this unique quality about this couple that they had. Let's move on. In the 8th verse, Luke 1, verse 8. So it was that while he was serving as priest before God in the order of his division, according to the custom of the priesthood, his lot fell to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord. And the whole multitude of the people was praying outside at the hour of incense. Now, this portion here, these three verses, seem to be a very standard kind of verse. This was what Zacharias was doing. His lot was to burn incense. The order, you know, the priests had different types of roles, different types of functions, and one of the functions of the priests was to burn incense. And so Zacharias, by lot, you know, that means it was just by chance, it was not that he was specially equipped for the task of burning incense. His lot fell to burn incense. Now, you know what happens is, when you put the incense on the altar, there would be fumes that would rise. So Zacharias could have said, my job is to burn incense. So he could have put the incense on the altar, the fumes would have gone up, and Zacharias could have said, my job is done. But praise God, Zacharias was not doing a job. He was serving as a priest before God. That's the key. That means, where you are, the task which God has given to you, the work that God has placed, has given in your hand, whatever it may be, it has to be a work unto God. It can't be a profession. It can't be a job. It can't be a vocation. You say, oh, I am doing a job, brother. No, you are not doing a job. Wherever you are serving God. I am serving God. Whatever, as I said, we may be in different, you know, in different fields, in different walks of life. Wherever God has kept you, in whatever role, in whatever capacity God has kept you, you are there to serve God, nothing else. Not men, not for promotion, not for increment, Not for, you know, some kind of advantage I will get if I do this job, you know, I will get some kind of posting somewhere and I will get some kind of, you know, benefit somewhere. Sadly, many of us do our work with all kinds of, you know, permutations and combinations. There's only one way to work. I work unto God. I work unto God. My reward comes from God. I leave my reward unto Him. Lord, I don't know, Lord, whether this world will reward me, recognize me, give me anything. I don't worry. I don't think about it. I don't worry about it. It doesn't bother me. My work is unto God. Is that how it is? This is separation from the world. The world doesn't understand this. The world works with agenda. When people in the world work, they want money, they want benefits, they want increment, they want, you know, all kinds of advantages, and that's the way they work. But you and I, we work as unto God all the time. All the time. Never looking for rewards. Never looking for promotion and saying, Lord, promotion comes from You. Reward comes from You. I'm willing to wait. Are you prepared for that kind of a life? That is holiness. That is the kind of relationship God expects from us. But many of us, you know, we have our own agenda in life. And then we want God to also step in and make sure that our agenda gets fulfilled. So we want promotion, we want this, we want that. Then we go to God and say, Lord, I want my promotion, Lord. Why has my promotion not come? And we go to God and we want God to meet our needs. As long as God is meeting our needs and doing whatever we want, He's a good God. He's a good God. Friends, when are we going to learn that your work is always unto God? Nothing else. Zachariah served as a priest unto God. His burning the incense had a meaning. Let's turn to, Revelation, keep your finger in Luke's Gospel chapter 1. We'll come back. We are definitely going to come back to Luke 1. But let's turn quickly to Revelation chapter 5 and verse 8. Revelation 5:8. Now when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. Now what is, so therefore when Zacharias burnt the incense on the altar and the fumes were rising up, what was the meaning? What was the significance? The significance is what you read there in Revelation chapter 5 and verse 8. The incense which are the prayers of the saints. Let's look at another verse, another passage in Revelation chapter 8, verses 3 and 4. Revelation 8, 3 and 4. Then another angel having a golden censer came and stood at the altar. He was given much incense that he should offer it with the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. And the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the saints ascended before God from the angel's hands. So you see that there was a significance. When the incense was put on the altar and the fumes would go up, it signified the prayers of the saints. Now you come back to Luke's Gospel, chapter 1, and you see the passage again that we just read. It says there, verse 10, Luke 1:10, and the whole multitude of the people was praying outside at the hour of incense. So you see what is happening here? Zacharias was placing the incense on the altar. The fumes were rising up. It was not a job. It was not just a task of putting fumes and putting the incense and the fumes rising up. The task was the prayers of the people. People's prayer was going up. And Zachariah, being a priest, was lifting up the prayers of the people to God. This was his job. This was what he was doing. He was lifting up the prayers of the people to God because it was a priesthood. It was a work of being a priest unto God. Friends, to me, this is very exciting. You know, we need to discover wherever we are. You may be doing a so-called very routine work, but you need to discover how your routine work connects with giving glory to God. It may be in your company, it may be in the government office, it may be in your school or college or wherever God has kept you. You need to find out how the work you are doing is bringing glory to God, is connecting with God, is bringing, you know, relationship right with God. And that is our work. that is our work. We need to fine-tune ourselves to that, and that is what we need to be doing. Many of us, you know, don't even bother. We look at our job as a job. I'm there to earn money. I'm looking after myself, brother. I'm getting my bread. My income is coming. That's why I'm working here. As long as I'm an honest worker, that's enough. Sorry, you are working where you're working unto God. Find out what your work is, how your work connects with God, and begin to do that. I tell you, we will be very different people in our workplace. We will be holy people because we will be separated from the world. The world will not work like that. The world will work with agenda, personal agenda. But you will work as unto God. You and I will work unto God. Zechariah was working unto God. Now look at what happens here. Is beautiful. It's amazing. 11th verse. Luke 1 verse 11. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zechariah saw him, he was troubled and fear fell upon him. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zacharias, for your prayer is heard." I've been saying till now, Zacharias was praying for the people. People's prayer was being lifted up. Zacharias was doing his priesthood unto God. He was lifting up the prayer of the people to God. The angel comes and says, "Zechariah, your prayer is heard." You know what happens? When you and I are fulfilling God's work, God knows our deepest pain. You don't even have to pray. God will answer your deepest pain. The secret for God to answer your deepest pain is not to worry about it and go to God repeatedly and say, "God, please solve my problem." But focus on the task, focus on the work, focus on what God is doing with people. Begin to do that. God will tell you, "My child, your prayer is heard. Your prayer is heard. Because I know what you're doing is as unto God. What you're doing is unto God." Many of us are struggling because, you know, we are not in that dimension. Gabriel comes and tells Zechariah, "Zechariah, your prayer is heard, Zechariah." Whereas Zechariah was praying for the people. In all genuineness, he was praying for the people. And the angel says, "Zechariah, your prayer is heard." This is our God, friends. This is our God. This is how much he loves us. And he wants us to have that closeness and that intimacy with him. When he come to the cross, let's not look at the cross on a transactional basis. Let's not come to the cross and say, "Oh, my sins are forgiven." But come to the cross and say, "Oh Lord, how much you love me, Lord. How much you love me. Forgive me, Lord, for my selfishness. Forgive me, Lord, for my short-sightedness. I come to you with my own agenda. Lord, help me to focus on you, on your purpose, on your work and your task and your people. And when I do that, Lord, I know you will hear my prayer. The deepest concern of my heart, Lord, you will hear. You will surely hear." Because God wants to see how much are we connected with the things that burden the heart of God, that are God's concerns, and God answers our prayer. So Gabriel said that. 13th verse, "But the angel said to him, 'Do not be afraid, Zacharias, for your prayer is heard. And your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John.'" Now let's go a little deeper into this purpose itself. The 14th verse. "And you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth." Now let's remember this, that John, about whom this whole passage is about, has not even appeared. He is not in the scene at all. Okay? He has not even come into the scene. But God has already planned the purpose, the task that God had, you know, that he was fulfilling. And you and I must always remember that. God is already, you know, at work. He has got a plan. You and I are just co-laborers with God. Co-workers with God. We have the privilege of being co-workers with God. Sometimes we think we are doing something great. You and I are not doing anything great. You know, we are getting the privilege to tag along with God, piggyback with God. I'll give you a small story to help illustrate this point. There was a little boy who was playing outside his house. And the neighbor, you know, came out of his house, and the neighbor was trying to start his car, and the car was not starting. So he told the little fellow, he said, "Son, go and call your daddy and come. I need somebody to push my car so that my car will start." So the little fellow ran inside the house and told his daddy, "Daddy, uncle's car is not starting." come and push, we need to push his car to get it started. So his dad came and, pushed the car. And this little fellow said, small fellow, 5 years old, 4 years old fellow, he said, "Daddy, can I also push the car?" So dad said, "Push, you also push." So he put his little, small little hands at the back of the car. His daddy pushed, the uncle's car started. He went running to his mother, said, "Mommy, mommy, daddy and I pushed the car." Daddy and I pushed the car and the car started. Many of us think we are doing ministry. You are only a little boy putting your hand at the back of the car. You are not doing anything. God is doing everything. We must always remember that. We must always keep that in focus. Otherwise, we'll become too bloated. Our heads will become very bloated. I am doing ministry. You're not doing any ministry. You're only a co-worker. You and I are only co-workers and co-laborers with God. We have the privilege to put our hand at the back of the car. That's all. God does the work. And always we must remember that. And this is the privilege that God has given us. John the Baptist had not even appeared. God was already at work. Remember that when we are part of this purpose of God, we are wholly aligned with Him. We must be saying, "Lord Jesus, what a privilege it is for me to be to work alongside with you and to be part of your purpose." So here is this whole work of John being explained here from the 14th verse, Luke's Gospel chapter 1. "And you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth." One of the key indicators about us being part of God's purpose is that we will bring joy into the lives of people. You and I, when you are in tune with the purpose of God, when you are accomplishing God's purpose, you will bring joy into the lives of people. People will have joy because of you and because of me. Ask this question. When you step into a room, when you step into a small group of people, are they happy or do they want to get away? This difficult person has come. This person has spoiled the joy. Create trouble for us. Let's walk away. You got to test yourself. Are you bringing joy to people? Does your life automatically bring joy to people around you? Sadly, many of us don't bring joy. We bring a lot of confusion wherever we go. If you are part of God's purpose, you will bring joy. That was a clear indicator. When John comes, he will bring joy. People will rejoice at his birth, the angel said. Friends, that is a clear indicator of being in tune with God, being a part of his purpose. If you and I have to be holy, separated people, we will bring joy. We need to ask ourselves, what kind of a person am I? What kind of a life am I living? Am I bringing joy to people? Then move on. 15th verse, Luke 1:15. "For he will be great." Now we're talking about John, okay? "For he will be great in the sight of the Lord and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. He will also be filled with the Holy Spirit even from his mother's womb." So there are three important ideas, important thoughts that Gabriel is communicating about John. "For he will be great in the sight of the Lord, then he will drink neither wine nor strong drink. He will also be filled with the Holy Spirit." First of all, he will be great in the sight of the Lord. Now the first thing that we need to understand when we talk about greatness in God's sight is just the diametrically opposite of greatness from the world's perspective. The world treats greatness in many ways. They will say how much money you make and how much of a bank balance you have, what kind of a car you drive, which kind of a flat you live in, which apartment you're living. All these are the indicators for the world to define greatness. But for God, greatness is defined absolutely differently. Let's turn to Matthew's Gospel chapter 20 from verse 26 onwards. Matthew 20, 26 onwards. Look at what Jesus says, Matthew 20, 26. "Yet it shall not be so among you, but whoever desires to become great among you, let him be your servant. And whoever desires to be first among you, let him be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life a ransom for many." The whole understanding of greatness is totally made upside down as far as Jesus is concerned. In Jesus' greatness, great person is the one who is a servant. Who is the one who doesn't want name. Who is not looking for position. Who is not looking for status. Who says, "I am willing to be a servant. I am willing to be forgotten. I am willing to be put aside." Are we? I wonder. I remember I was invited to speak in a church, and I was waiting. They were doing a lot of things, formalities, and then I was going to speak. So because it was the final message of a series of meetings, they said they'll do the vote of thanks also before I gave the message. So I think it was the secretary of the church who was giving the vote of thanks. And this man, started reading the vote of thanks. He read everybody's name. He said the flower arrangement committee, chairman of that committee, secretary of the committee, then the reception committee, then I don't know, hundreds of committees were there. And everybody's name he read, this is the chairperson of that and the secretary of this committee. And he said, I want to thank you. And he read everybody's name, and he was breathless actually by the time he finished reading all those names. Then he told the congregation, the crowd, he said, if by chance I have missed your name, please don't get angry with me. I didn't do it intentionally. I might have missed it. Please don't get angry. Don't get upset. And I said, what kind of a church is this? That if their name is not read, they'll get upset. I'm asking St. Andrew's Kirk, what kind of a church is this? Is it a church who says, I'm willing to be forgotten? I don't need name. I'm here to serve. I'm only here to serve. I don't need position. I don't need recognition. I don't need to be in any committee. I will serve. Are we ready for that? This is greatness. This is part of holiness. This is what it means to say, Lord, we are one with you. We don't need what the world wants. We don't need it, Lord. We are willing to serve, and we're willing to serve. That's the first point that Jesus gave in the 15th verse. He will be great in the sight of the Lord. Second one, he shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. And to me, that statement there talks about our physical holiness. Set apart in terms of our physical holiness. Who are you? Psychologists say that man's character is about who you are and who I am in the dark. It is not how we project ourselves in front of people. I can stand here and I can say whatever I want to say about myself. But God says, Valentine, I'm looking at your heart. I'm looking at that inner person. Because character is who you are and who I am in the dark where nobody sees us. The question is, who are you? Who am I? Where nobody sees us, am I clean on the inside? Am I clean on the inside? Is there holiness on the inside? Am I set apart on the inside? Or is my inner person rotting? Is my inner person rotting? Is the question we'll have to ask ourselves. God is expecting to see in our hearts. The man, God says man sees the outward appearance. God sees the heart. God sees us when no one else can see us. And this evening, friends, this evening, question to all of us, young and old. Who are you in the dark? Who are you in the dark? Is there holiness there? Have you set yourself apart? Have you said, God, there's filthiness on the inside. Nobody knows, Lord. Nobody knows. They think I'm like this. They think I'm that. But Lord, you know who I am. In the inner person, there's horrible filthiness. Lord, I come to you broken. Lord, have mercy on me. We need to come to God with tears and say, Lord, have mercy on me. Lord, I need you. I need you, Lord, to change me on the inside. And it's only God who can heal us on the inside. Nothing else will be able to set us free. We need to come to Him and come to Him to seek that change and transformation on the inside. Then the third aspect that God is talking, the message is given to Zacharias is, he will drink neither wine nor strong drink. He will also be filled with the Holy Spirit even from his mother's womb. The third dimension of what the angel was communicating was that there has to be the filling of the Spirit. Now, many times, we kind of get a little nervous with this word, with this phrase, filled with the Spirit. Somehow we begin to think this is something very Pentecostal and this is not supposed to be for us. I don't know how we got that. This is, God is expecting every one of us to be Spirit-filled people. There is no room for the flesh. In this walk with God, because if you read, I'm sure you're familiar with Romans chapter 8, but please go and study Romans chapter 8, and you will know that very clearly it says, they that are in the flesh cannot please God. In fact, you are walking in the flesh, you will die. Paul says, you will die if you walk in the flesh. We are called, we people are always in the spirit. Now let me explain this again. Let me give a kind of an illustration to help us understand this whole issue of in the spirit, walking in the spirit and walking in the flesh. Now imagine you are in a swimming pool, okay? And imagine there's about 4.5 feet water or 5 feet water. And you're in the swimming pool, your feet is on the floor of the swimming pool, your head is just slightly above the level of the water. And you try to, you know, move your hands around and try to tell people standing outside the swimming pool, I'm swimming. But your feet is on the floor. Feet is absolutely on the floor and you are trying to move and you're moving your arms. Head is slightly above the water and you're telling people that you're swimming. And you know it's nonsense. You're not swimming because you're walking on the water. Many of us as Christians are not living the spirit-filled life at all. Let me make it categorical. We are not living spirit-filled life at all. We are absolutely, our feet is on the floor. And we are pretending. We are doing all kinds of actions. Oh, I'm moving with the Lord. I'm moving in the spirit. Nothing is happening. You are on the floor. Your feet are on the floor. Walking in the spirit requires, like in swimming, the feet has to be taken off from the floor of the swimming pool. And the body now is now submitted to the dynamics of the water. Water takes over and then you have an entirely different experience of swimming. That is what God expects from us. You cannot say, I'm spirit-filled and actually live in the flesh. This dual kind of life is not on. And we need to come to God and say, Lord, forgive me, Lord, that I'm pretending. All these years, I'm pretending that I'm spirit-filled. Nothing is happening. I'm actually, my feet is on the floor of the swimming pool. To come to God and say, Lord, I need you, Lord. Lord, I need you to take over my life completely, 100%, no more myself. You have to live, Lord. You have to live in me. I'm surrendered to you. Like the swimmer surrenders to the dynamics of the water and say the water takes over. That kind of a surrender has to happen. Friends, this evening the question is, how many of us are actually living in the dimension of the spirit? Or are you a pretender? Pretending to live in the spirit, but actually the feet is on the floor of the swimming pool. That's the third aspect that the angel talked about. 15th verse. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord, shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. He will also be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. 16th verse. And he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. One of the indicators again of holiness. When we are in God's purpose, we will turn many to the Lord. Many will turn to the Lord because of your life, because of my life. You cannot stop it. When you are separated unto God, when you are in intimate relationship with God, when you are in love, when you are in a love relationship with God, friends, there will be a power that will come out of you, that will come out with such power, such force that others will be attracted. For the others around you will say, if this is who Valentine is, I want that life. I want that experience. Is your life a magnetic life that people are drawn to the Lord because of the kind of person you are? Ask yourself the question. What kind of an impact is your life creating in the circles that God has kept you in? Each of us have got circles. People whom nobody else can touch, only you can touch. Those circles of people, you are the only one who can influence them. And God is one day going to ask you the question. You know, I kept you in that place, I kept you in that company, I kept you in that situation, and there was this 10 people, there's 15 people whom your life was influencing. What happened to them? Have they turned? If there's no holiness, how can people turn to the Lord? Praise God. God's purpose is that when we are separated unto God, people will be drawn to the Lord. That's what the 16th verse says. And he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. Then 17th verse, he will also go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Ultimately, our whole task of being holy unto God is to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Friends, this nation, you know, is given to us. This nation of India has been given to us. 1.2 billion people, 1.2 billion plus people have been given to the hand of the church. We are here to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. That is why we are here as church. We are not here to just, run church. We are here because of this large nation of people to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Are we in tune with God, fulfilling His purpose and saying, Lord, I'm making ready a people prepared for you? Will this nation of 1.2 billion people, when they meet the Lord, will they tell the Lord, Lord, these people were genuine, they prepared us, but we are the ones who rejected you? Will they tell us, or will they say, we never understood God at all from the church? The church was busy in its own programs, but church never impacted us. We never understood God. I wonder what answer this nation will give to the Lord on the judgment day. I fear that day. Because God has kept us here to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. That is why we are here. That is our job responsibility. That's our job responsibility. We are here to make ready a people prepared for the Lord, not just to have church, but to look at this nation, to pray for this nation, to agonize for this nation. A nation which is full of issues, full of problems. Who will agonize for this nation? Who will pray for the terrible things that we do to our women in our nation? Who will pray for the abuse that happens in our nation? Who will pray for the corruption that happens in our nation? If the church does not pray, who will? Who will? Make ready a people prepared for the Lord. That is our work. Friends, this is what God expects from us. This is the holiness that He's expecting from us. This is the separation that He's expecting from us. That is why He had that love relationship with us. He called us a special people, a special treasure, a treasure unto Himself. And if we don't heed His heart and tune ourselves to Him, His heart is already broken. His heart is already a broken heart. He looks at our society, our people, and He looks at all the evil, the terrible wickedness that's happening. God's heart is broken. Will we also add to the brokenness of God's heart? Or will we people whom God look and say, my beloved children, how wonderfully they are living. How wonderfully they have understood my purpose. How wonderfully they are living a separated life. Will that be God's response for us? I wish that would be the case. I wish God would look at the church here and say, beautiful people who love me, who are in a love relationship with me. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that when we understand your heart, your plan, and Lord, that Father, you came into this world, Lord, not just to die for our sins, which is true, Lord, but more than that, you came because you wanted to restore that love relationship with you, to be one with you, not to be separated from you, Lord, to be one with you. And Lord, there is the work, Lord, involved in being one with you. Father, help us to understand what holiness means, and help us to apply that into our lives. We thank you, Father. We praise you and worship you, Lord. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.